Hi, I'm Aoife, and this is Backchat. It's the show that captures your comments from Facebook, Twitter, and the Escapist forums, and then uses them to start a dinosaur theme park in San Diego. Or was that InGen from The Lost World? Anyway, we also want to chat about what you want to chat about. So if you have any pressing questions or requests, post us a comment and we'll see what we can do. On that note, last week we were talking about upcoming FPS Syndicate, and we asked you which three sci-fi characters you'd have fill out your team. There were some pretty interesting combinations, although we're pretty sure that Sunburst's pairing of Captain Jack Harkness with Han Solo would cause the group to implode due to the sheer weight of sexual aggressiveness. Per Scotty. For our money, Shotgun Guy got the mix just right with Darth Vader, Bishop from Aliens, and Gray Fox from Metal Gear. It's the perfect match. Gray Fox is a throw-yourself-at-the-robot-dinosaur kind of guy. Just stand in between you and Vader and boom, instant relative safety. The only letdown is Bishop, who'll probably just sit in the corner spitting up milk. Your choices got us to thinking who would make the perfect science fiction team from gaming. First up, it's got to be Samus on your team. She's not only the galaxy's premier bounty hunter, but if you get bored on your ship, she's great for a kickabout. Then we've opted for Abe from Oddworld for two reasons. One, he can possess people, and two, he looks low maintenance. You have to think about these things when you're managing a sci-fi team. I mean, just imagine the cost of all those batteries to power Samus's power suit. Abe's got a loincloth and off he goes. Rounding out our team is the best character from Final Fantasy VII and the object of my obsession, Tifa Lockhart. Not only can she handle herself in a fight against pretty much anything, but if we teamed up, we'd be Tifa and Aoife. I've already got the t-shirts printed. True story. Moving on from space soap opera to more serious matters. Look what I got. Seeing as I haven't put it down in about a week now, which made washing my hands difficult, I thought I'd give you a summary on my thoughts on the Vita so far. Just a minute. Yeah. First off, it's incredibly light. I mean, I first played it at E3, and now that they've removed the lock attached to the wall, attached to the man with the Rottweiler and the kind of face that says don't, it's apparent just how light it is. I mean, at this rate, if you get bored with it, you can't even use it as an expensive paperweight. Looks-wise, it's really slick, neatly laid out, buttons all within easy reach. It's good. My only gripe would be the see-through plasticiness of the shoulder buttons. For this kind of money, I want shoulder buttons made out of gold or Fabergé eggs or angel's tears or something. Also, the memory card. Now, a lot of people are grumbling about Sony forcing you to use its proprietary and rather expensive memory card. I mean, look at this, 40 quid for this teeny tiny little thing. It's just, nobody move, no one move. Uh-oh. But obviously, the thing everyone wants to know about is the games. We spent some time with a lot of the launch window titles, and we thought we'd run down our favorites and why. Let's start by donning the cape of Captain Obvious and chat Uncharted Golden Abyss, the most technically impressive game of the bunch. The limitations of the Vita may mean that the gameplay lacks some of the razzle-dazzle of Uncharted 2 and 3, but as an experience that apes the Drake's Fortune formula, it's near flawless. One minor issue, the touch controls feel a little bit too tacked on to be anything other than a novelty. And if you insist on using the Vita's gyro to control your sniper rifle, just make sure you're in a swivel chair. Stuart Wash on Facebook is interested to know how Wipeout is playing. Now, I'm not a big fan of racing games. I mean, most of my time spent on Gran Turismo was getting acquainted with the barriers. And my curse words per hour greatly exceed the car's MPH. I mean, if all the cars were running on swearing, I'd be driving for McLaren. But Wipeout is just really fun. It's next-gen stunning, engrossing, nail-biting, and could easily compete with any home console equivalent. Big thumbs up for that then. even if the Backchat swear jar just cleaned me out. Cameron Aitken wonders, how are the graphics and how smooth is the touchscreen? Wipeout proves that the Vita is capable of highly detailed home console level graphics, but if you're looking for striking and stylized visuals integrated with slick touchscreen control, Escape Plan may be for you. The Tim Burton-ish world of Little and Large has a little of Lemmings in it and a little of Limbo. You have to guide the two gormless goons through a series of death traps using prods, pokes, and pats on the rear. Touchpad. It takes nimble fingers to get right, but it's a hugely satisfying cerebral and physical workout, and the creepy German expressionist art style is, in a word, perfect. James Liam O'Neill is not convinced. He thinks the Vita is just a PSP with a few gimmicks tacked on and isn't worth the extra money. We think Gravity Rush might change his mind. The latest from Sony's Japan studio is a gorgeous anime-styled action platformer hybrid with a physics-bending twist, and is easily the most intriguing of the Vita's launch window lineup. 5 minutes on this puppy and meh turns into gimme. Plus, it's got a cat made of stars in it, which is much better than my cat. It's just made of cat. Stupid cat. So, that's what we think. But what about you? There's been 25 odd titles announced. What's missing? And what do you want to see next? Drop me a line on Twitter, post us a comment below, and until next Tuesday,
subscribe.
Hey, Aoife. How are you doing?
She doesn't talk like that.
Yes, I talk like this. I've always talked like this.
She doesn't stop it.
God, I wish I was Aerith. She's got such nice clothes.